The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil.' He said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, 'How much do you owe?' He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So the first question I asked at the early service this morning was, would anybody else like to preach on this text? And I didn't get any takers then either. It's always the question, what do you do with a parable like this? It is such a difficult one, especially when it seems like one of the main characters in the story, especially the parable portion of it, seems to do almost everything wrong or dishonestly or underhandedly, and it's all about himself. And yet in the parable, what do we hear? He is the one that gets commended. That part just makes no sense to us. And to be honest, the only consensus that you can get when you read commentaries about this passage is that it is confusing and no one quite gets it. That's about the only thing that all of the commentaries that you can read seem to have in common. This man, this shrewd manager, is accused of doing something wrong with the manager's money. We don't even know for sure whether he has or whether he hasn't, but he's at least accused of it. And then he tries to cheat his way into the good graces of other people by forgiving a portion of their debt. And then he is commended for his shrewdness. Now, some will tell you that the manager, or that this shrewd manager was really only cheating the wealthy man out of the money. Others say that the man was commended because he acted with vision. He acted with forethought about what was coming in his future. Some scholars will talk about this parable as the internal struggle that we all face when having to deal with questions and decisions, whether to choose God or anything else first. Still others bring up the notion of the financial inequality in the ancient world. It's not necessarily gone away today. But in the ancient world, where interest rates were so high that especially when poor folks borrowed money, they could never, ever possibly repay it. And so that maybe this man was really just forgiving the interest that had been accrued already, or maybe he was just giving back his portion of the proceeds that he was making. Well, it really doesn't matter whether you pick one or a couple of them, or whether it's a little bit of truth in all of those things that we find in the commentaries. As I said before, one thing is certain, and that's that there is nothing that is certain about this parable. One of the most interesting pieces about the first part of the text, though, for me, is the passage that reads, "For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light." The children of this age in this particular passage is talking about people who were not Christians, people without their faith, and the children of light being God's people, people who walk the path of discipleship. I think the other thing to note about that particular verse is the word shrewd. If you think about it for a moment, at least for me, when I hear that word shrewd, it's usually not an absolutely wonderful person that I think of. When I hear the word shrewd, I think about someone who is probably a bit cutthroat, probably even acting a bit underhandedly. But in this passage, the thing we need to remember is that shrewd can also be translated as wise or prudent. So what is it about this manager that makes him wise? Well, think about it for a moment. Here's this man whose world is just about ready to come crumbling down around him. His means of providing for himself, we don't know if he has a family, but providing for himself at least is coming to an end, and coming to an end rather abruptly. The wisdom comes with the fact that he begins to make plans. Regardless of the question of honest or dishonest, he begins to make plans for his future. He's realistic about his situation. He knows what's coming and is looking ahead. And he utilizes everything that he has at his disposal in order to provide for himself. Now, as a church, I don't think that should be our primary goal. It's not a matter of doing everything that we can to provide for ourselves. As Jesus says at the end of the passage, you can't serve God and wealth. But it is our goal to make things better, or rather to further God's mission and God's ministry in this place. So I think the first thing that we're called to do, like the manager, is to be realistic about our position, about where we are and who we are, and what we're called to be as Trindle Spring Lutheran Church here in Mechanicsburg. Strategic. We're supposed to be wise in our planning, and we're supposed to use all of the gifts that we have at our disposal. That's part of what I think this shrewd manager teaches us this morning. But I think some of these places are also where the church as a whole is sometimes a bit lacking. Now, first of all, we don't always like to be realistic about our situation or about where we are as a church. I mean, let's face it, as a denomination, the ELCA has been in decline for a number of years now. As congregations, we have conflict. We have issues. We are imperfect, whether we like to admit it or not. They're there. And as individuals, sometimes we have to admit that our personal preferences might get in the way of growth, of faith growing in our midst, and our ability to reach out to new people with the gospel. We need to be more shrewd. We've heard over and over again about being in the world, but not of the world. You've probably heard that phrase before, and I agree. But it doesn't mean that the talents and the skills and the gifts that people have in other areas of the world, other than just their church world, when we have those skills and talents and gifts, it doesn't mean we don't use them for the glory of God and the benefit of God's kingdom. We should be more wise and use all of the tools in our toolbox. That's why doing things like developing the Facebook page or the website and a lot of other things are so important, because they're simply tools that we have for conveying the gospel message. But the most important tool, most important means that God has for reaching out to other people right now is you and me. The most important tool that God has in God's toolbox is the body of Christ, those human relationships. I think the shrewd manager actually knew that pretty well. He knew that the only way he was going to be able to provide for himself, the only way that he stood a chance once he lost this job, were those relationships, those people that he forgave debts for, so that they would welcome him into their homes, into their houses. The same is true for the kingdom of God, in a way. We are called to utilize God's people, ourselves, in order to build up the kingdom of God. Furthering God's kingdom is about serving God first, not the self-serving kind of thing that the shrewd manager does, but serving God. And it's about being the tools God uses to connect with other people. We are those tools. We are called to be those tools that God uses to connect to the community around us, even those who have never experienced faith or God in their lives before. I think one of the last things that this shrewd manager has to teach us this morning is about vision. He sees what's coming, or at least what could happen if he doesn't prepare for it, and so he does. He plans accordingly. Here at Trendle Spring, that means a couple of things. Right now, we're in the midst of a process for developing a mission statement, a vision statement, things that will help guide us and discern where is it that God is calling us to be? Who is it that God is calling us to be right now? And what are the things that we're called to next? From this flawed and dishonest, this shrewd manager, we hear about the need for us to look at our reality, to evaluate it, to see it for what it is, to see the tools that we have and to utilize each and every one, and to have a vision, to have a plan for God's ministry in this place. Most importantly, I think what we take from our last sentence of our gospel today, that in everything we do, we serve God first. Whether it's visioning, whether it's long-range planning, whether it's outreach, whether it's hospitality, whether it's Christian education, whether it's coming for worship, everything that we do is done in service to God. We must serve God first. We may not always know what to do with a passage like this. We might not always get the translations exactly right of what we should be learning. We might not always be able to understand what it is that Jesus is teaching his disciples or even us today in this passage. But I think one thing in this passage is crystal clear. Above anything else in our lives, we must always put God first. Amen.